Good day to you. We're back here in ESS Hydrology and Hydraulics Laboratory to look at another way we can use the Reynolds number to get at an interesting biological question. And in this instance, it's the only way we can get at the question because the animals we're interested in have been extinct for more than 70 million years. We're all familiar with these creatures. This is a 1/50th scale model of a Triceratops dinosaur. And what makes these creatures distinctive, of course, is the extensive bony frill that extends from the back of the skull. Now here's the interesting question, what was this frill for? Paleontologists have a lot of ideas for this. One is that they use these as some kind of a sexual or dominance or threat display device. But we can't look at dinosaur behavior directly anymore, of course. The frill, so to speak, is gone. Another possibility is that they use the frill for thermoregulation. Again, it's a reasonable idea, but can we take it any further than this? The answer is yes, we can. If the frill was used as a thermoregulatory device, it should make air flow around it in a particular way. And we already know that we can visualize flows by using fluorescein dye in water. So here's the question. Can we take a small model, put it into water, and visualize flows around the frill, and understand something about how air might have flowed around a full-size triceratops in air, a full-size triceratops that is 9 meters long, from here to the back of the wall over there? This is where the Reynolds number becomes important. Let's calculate what we can do. Our Triceratops model is about 18 centimeters long. An actual Triceratops is about 50 times larger, or 9 meters long. The best speed we can get from our small flume is about 3 centimeters per second, or about 0.03 meters per second. This gives us a Reynolds number of our model in water of about 5,400. The same Reynolds number in air for a 9 meter long animal would occur at a wind speed of only about 1 centimeter per second, quite slow. So we can say something about flow around an animal, but only under very limited circumstances. That is, only under very limited breezes, very light breezes. It's not perfect, but at least it's a start. So with that proviso, let's take some triceratops and sink them in our water tunnel.
Let's start by looking at flows when the animal is facing into the wind. We'll look at flow from a series of dye injection points going from high off the ground and working our way down. From a point high off the ground, we see that the frill tends to divert air flow upward over the animal's back, but other than that, interacts little with the frill. Closer to the frill, though, the situation has changed dramatically. Note here the vigorous generation of turbulent vortices at the frill margin and the retained turbulent vortex along the rear surface of the frill. There's a lot of mixing going on here. If we look a little further down the snout, we still see the strong generation of vortices at the frill margin and the retained vortex behind, but now we see something else. Note the retrograde flow being set up here. We know what that means. Where there's retrograde flow, there's turbulence being generated somewhere. Now let's turn to what happens with wind coming straight at the animal at about eye level. Here we place the dye injection point right above the animal's snout. Again, look at the vigorous generation of turbulence behind the frill. But we see something else that's interesting. The retrograde flow along the snout we just observed is part of another turbulence-generating mechanism, this one involving the horns. Finally, what about flows from a point lateral to the head at about eye level? Here, we see that the frill diverts airflow toward the animal and directs it upward along the fringe and along its rear face. Thus, air that would normally pass the animal by is brought up into close proximity with the surface of the vascularized frill. This, in combination with the generation of the turbulent vortex behind the frill, means there's a lot of mixing of air going on behind it. What about when the animal is facing downwind? For the most part, air seems to flow over the body, but a close look around the head shows there's some mixing going on there as well. Let's take a closer look. Clearly, the frill generates some complex flows around it. There's very clear generation of turbulence, but there's something more. Look how flow is directed first downward along the frill's lateral margins, and then upward along the frill's front edge. Clearly, wind from the rear will promote heat exchange, but mostly along the animal's face. Some Triceratops relatives had relatively small frills like this one. Did these generate turbulence as well? Well, yes and no. When the animal faces upwind, it appears that this small frill is less effective at generating turbulence. When the animal faces downwind, however, even this small fringe generates a fair bit of turbulent mixing along the animal's face. This should promote heat loss from the face as well, just as it does in the large triceratops. So to summarize, when the animal faces into the wind, there's a strong generation of turbulence around the frill's margins. When the animal faces downwind, the frill will induce a strong retrograde flow of the front surface of the frill. Both will promote heat exchange between the frill and air.
So what have we learned? We've learned two things, really. The first is that there are some fairly complex air flows around the frill. And the second is that even at the very low wind speeds that we would have been looking at, there's considerable turbulence that's generated around those frills. And this turbulence would have provided a tremendous boost for heat loss from the surface of the frill. So even though we haven't eliminated the possibility that the frill could have been some kind of behavioral display device, we've bolstered the idea that the frill can act as a thermoregulatory device, and we've bolstered it with observation. So that's all for today. The hot-blooded dinosaur lives.
I recall the time they found those fossilized mosquitoes, and before long they were cloning DNA. Now I'm being chased by some irate velociraptors. Well, believe me, this has been one lousy day.